السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، آمين يا رب العالمين. ما بعد، فقد قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: فاذكروا الله كما علمكم ما لم تكونوا تعلمون، رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي، واللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله، واللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، آمين يا رب العالمين. My intention this month, as much time as I can share with you inshallah ta'ala, is to go through two things. One night I'm going to be talking about Allah Azza wa Jal, and the next night I'll be talking about His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But I'll be taking a very specific road in talking about Allah and His Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. When I speak about Allah, I shared an ayah with you that is part of an ayah or belonging to Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah says you should remember Allah the way He taught you, the way you didn't know yourself. Allah Azza wa Jal has taught us ways to remember Him, and really remembering Allah is the foundation of our relationship with Allah. Allah Azza wa Jal is in the unseen to us, and the bind, the rope that connects us to Allah is remembering Him. And now remembering Allah can vary from one person to another. I can remember Allah my own way, you can remember Allah your own way. But Allah mentions in this ayah that calls on all of us to remember Him the way He taught us to remember Him. And that way that we could never have known ourselves. مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ. You had no possibility of knowing how to remember Allah on your own. Part of that is the way He describes Himself. You know, Muslims, non-Muslims, anybody who believes in God has some image or some idea of what God is or who God is. Ask anybody who believes in God, they'll say, yeah, God is good, God loves, God's wise, etc., etc. They have some concept of some descriptions of God in their mind. But Allah Azza wa Jal goes far beyond that, describing Himself in ways that we could never have imagined ourselves. That's what it means when He says, مَا لَمْ تَكُونُوا تَعْلَمُونَ, in ways you could not have ever known yourselves. Human beings can have some concept of Allah, some concept of a God, but they can't go beyond their own imagination or their own limited thoughts or whatever Allah has put inside the fitrah. Some knowledge of Allah is there, some level of light is there, but the complete light can only come from Allah Azza wa Jalla, and that is the revelation that He gave to His final messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So my intention is to actually, first and foremost, as I was trying to prepare for this series, you know, as I dive into this subject, there's so much to explore and so much to learn, then I have to take a step back and ask myself, what is my intention for you? My job as someone who's learning, and then my job as someone who's trying to share and teach. My job for you is to be able to, at the end of this month, take away something about Allah that you can keep with you in your heart. And if you and I can accomplish that, then we've accomplished some level of success. And so as a result of that, I want to start with something that everybody's familiar with. Some people here are much more knowledgeable than I am, and I know that as a fact. And some people here have memorized the entire Quran and are, you know, experts in the Arabic language. And other people here barely know how to read the Fatiha. There are other people here that maybe have been Muslim for 2 days. So there are people at all kinds of levels here. And I have to consider that someone listening and somebody trying to benefit may belong to any one of those levels, and they need to be able to walk away with something regardless of what they know. So I want to start with one matter. And that is what I'm hoping to share with you isn't, and if you can look at me, isn't for up here. It's actually not knowledge that I wish to share with you. I'm hoping to develop something for here, for myself and for all of you, in the way Allah told us to remember. Because when Allah talked about remembering Him, He says, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرَى لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ. In it, there's a powerful reminder. In the Quran, there's a powerful reminder for anyone who has a heart. So first of all, He said, remember Allah the way you couldn't have known. And then He says, remembrance is actually something that is done by people who have hearts. So we're trying to benefit our hearts as we engage in this exploration. So what I'm going to talk to you about the next couple of days, today and actually skipping after the day after, just about Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Something everybody knows, I would think.
Or if you don't know, it will be easy for you to learn, inshallah ta'ala. This phrase that Allah Azza wa Jal gave us, that is at the opening of every surah. Just some things about that phrase. You know, if you notice the writing and the script of the original Mus'haf and the early Masahif, the Ba used to be written long. The Ba is a flat letter like this. But the opening Ba in the Masahif, like Umar bin Abdul Aziz even argued and instructed the others, you know, in the early generations to write the Ba long when you write Bismillah. Why? Because this was out of glorifying and magnifying the magnificent letter Ba with which the Quran begins. This was out of their, you know, appreciation of the power of this letter. Now, what did they understand about the Ba that we don't know? We just say Bismillah and we keep moving along. But somehow the Sahaba and the early generations were mesmerized, were overwhelmed by the power of just that letter Ba when we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. You know, that Ba occurs before that too. When we say A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, there's a Ba there also. And that's also a Billah. But there's a difference between A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim and Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. A'udhu billah does not begin with the Ba. It begins with a fi'il, a'udhu, which you, if you don't know, that's okay. That'll come at a later time. But this phrase that we refer to, that we open the surahs of the Qur'an with and do so much else with, everything else you do, that's a good thing. You start with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Why is this ba' so important? The Basri, you know, scholars used to call it ba' al-ilsaq. The Kufans used to call it, you know, ba' al-ala. What that means in simple English is as follows. It means whatever you're doing, when you say this word, when you call on this ba in Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, whatever you're doing is attached to this phrase. Like they become one thing. They cannot be separated anymore. There's an ilsaq between what you do and what this ba does. It's fusing the two things together. So, and inshallah, in these few minutes, I'll explain what does it mean that what I do, for example, I'm eating, simple task. And before I start eating, I say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Now what the early scholars are arguing is that my eating has been combined with Allah's name, calling on Allah's name. It can't be separated from that anymore. So now we learn something important. There are things we do that are not attached to Allah's name. And there are other things we do that are attached to Allah's name. There's a difference between them now, because sometimes we forget to say what? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. If we forget to say it, then Allah's name is not attached to our act. And if we do say it, then Allah's name is attached to our act. What difference does it make? If you attach Allah's name or you don't attach Allah's name, you still ate a burger. You still drank orange juice. It still tasted the same. Nothing changed except Allah says, Subhanahu wa ta'ala, Tabarak asmu Rabbik. Tabarak asmu Rabbik. When you call on Allah's name and attach Allah's name to any act, then that act becomes full of something called barakah. And barakah in Arabic isn't just blessing. Barakah actually means something that becomes stable, something that stays in its place. Like birka was used for when a camel sits in the sand and won't move, and it sort of sinks into the sand. That's barakah al-ba'ir. That's actually from where the word comes from. And it also means increase. Meaning, the same orange juice, but because Allah's name is attached to it, you will get more nutrition from it, more benefit from it, your mind will open up, things will come out of this drink, benefits will come from this drink in the seen world and in the unseen world. Benefits for your body, benefits for your heart, that you could not have experienced if you didn't say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. That attachment changes everything. So now we're learning that our tasks are actually, in a sense, incomplete without Bismillah. That's just a little bit about the Ba. And by the way, Ba is also called by the Kufi scholars, they call it Ba al-Ala, which means the Ba of a means, like a tool. Meaning, you know how you say, I use the key to open the door? Right? I use the key, I use the hammer to put the nail in the wall. I'm using Bismillah to get this done. That's actually what that means. That I need this phrase, and without it, whatever I need to get done will not get done. I do not believe it will yield the intended results. If the basmala isn't there, if this phrase Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim isn't there. Now let's talk a little bit about the word ism. Bismillah. The word ism, though there's lots of arguments about that, and this is not the time to discuss complex Arabic, but it's argued that it comes from sumu, or samun, or simun, meaning height or elevation, and that the wow moves over. What that means simply is, you know, when you call somebody by their name, you've elevated them. And you're supposed to give people honorable names. When we call on Allah, and before we say Allah's name, we say the word ism, we say bismillah, we're actually acknowledging that Allah's names are high, that they are lofty, that they are of grand status, that we have to have respect and regard and appreciation for these magnificent names of Allah. And that just saying those names, just saying them, is an honor for us. Just that we get to say that. You know, and then after that, we say the word Allah, bismillah. By the way, the people that came before us, who were given the book before us, like Banu Israel, many of them actually went the opposite direction. They would actually even argue in their religious tradition, Allah's name should not be said. It's too sacred to be said. Don't call on Allah's name. He shall not be named. And they would have code names for God and not use Allah's actual name. Some of their scholars even considered it blasphemy to call on God by His name. And Allah begins His Quran and He tells us, call on His name. Call on and use His name. And attach everything you do with His name. Because without that name, it will be incomplete. And that's Bismillah. And since I was giving you the example of eating, you think about this. When you and I are eating, we thank Allah for being the provider. We thank Allah for sustaining us. We think of Allah's, primarily we think of Allah's attribute as the Raziq, the one who provides. That's one of Allah's names. But we don't say Bismir Raziq. We don't say in the name of the provider. I need the name of the provider to eat. We say in the name of who? Allah. We say in the name of Allah. You know, when a doctor is trying to treat a patient, and as they're treating, before they treat the patient, they don't say, you know, for Allah, you know, Bismi Shafi. Like in the name of the healer. Because Allah heals. He's not going to call on, or bismil, you know, muhyi. In the name of the one who gives life. The patient is, you know, in intensive care, and Allah is the only one who can preserve their life. So you call on Allah as the one who gives life, or the one who is the living, al-hayy, al-qayyum. But we don't say that. We say what? Bismillah. We just call on the word Allah. Why? Because the word Allah, unique to all the other names of Allah, the word Allah includes every description of Allah in one word. It includes Allah's love. It includes Allah's power. It includes Allah's wisdom. It includes Allah's planning. It includes Allah's healing. It includes Allah's anger. It includes Allah's knowledge. All of the names of Allah that you can think of, and you and I, our minds are not that sharp. We can't think of all of Allah's names. Even the ones we know don't come to mind. Even they don't come to mind. And yet Allah has given us a mercy that when we start something, we don't know which name of Allah we're going to need. I don't know if I need Allah to be my healer because I may have a sickness, I don't even know I have it. I may have a problem coming ahead of me, I don't even know it's coming ahead. I don't even know if this task is going to lead me into trouble and Allah, I will need Allah to be my protector. Maybe Allah, I need Allah to be my wali. Maybe Allah, I need Allah to be al-Hakim. Maybe I need Allah's knowledge for now. I need Allah to be al-Alim. I don't know which name of Allah I need. And so Allah knows better than we do. When we call on Allah by His name Allah, then Allah has covered all of the names we can't even think of. We don't even know what we need. Allah says, وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِذَاتِ الصُّدُورِ. Allah knows the nature of the chest. You know what that means? He knows what I'm thinking. And He knows my subconscious and the things I don't even know that I need. He knows those too. And I called on all of them just by using the word Allah. Just by using the word Allah. When I say Bismillah, I told you I'll need two sessions to do this because I wanted to dedicate an entire session to just Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Why that addition? Because you know, for short, we just say Bismillah. Bismillah, and we get started. But Allah Azza wa Jalla encouraged us to say what? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So of all of His names, He added those two. And there are so many of the names and descriptions of Allah, but He added those two in particular in this phrase, and that's important for us to study and understand. But before we do that, I want to take a little bit of time talking to you about just some things about this phrase, some more things about this phrase from a grammatical point of view. And even though I know, you know, most of you don't know the Arabic language, and that's okay, I'm going to try to make this as simple as I can in English so that it's easy to understand. And I'll throw in some technical terms here and there, but I'll simplify them, I promise. If I say, Using this key, I start my car. A simple example, I'll repeat it. Using this key, I start my car. And I change the sentence, and I say, I start my car using this key. It's the same idea, isn't it? One time I said, using this key, I start my car. And the other time I said, I start my car using this key. There's a difference, a little bit of a difference. And normally, you don't start with using this key. You start with what? I start my car using this key. You start with what you're doing, and then you mention what you're using. You understand? But if we think about Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, does our act come first? Or does what we're using, Allah's name, does that come first? Allah's name comes first. You know what? When you are heading to work, the only thing on your mind is, I gotta get to work. I gotta get in the car. When you're getting late, the only thing is, I gotta finish this plate. When the kids are getting late for school, hurry up, finish your breakfast. We gotta go, the bus is coming. There's the task in front of you is all you're thinking about. And Allah changes that for us. And He says, before you think of this task, before you think of what's right in front of you, using Allah's name first, meaning give due to Allah, the Creator, first. Give Him due first, and then think about your task. Your task and my task and whatever we're preoccupied with becomes secondary. Allah becomes primary. Because if Allah wasn't there, if Allah Azza wa Jalla's love and His mercy and His guidance and His power wasn't there, nothing we have to do in front of us would actually get done. It's a conscious awareness of our dependence on Allah Azza wa Jalla. You know, for grammar students, this is something remarkable. The first time I learned this, I was overwhelmed. They say in Nahu, they teach you about taqdeem and ta'khir. You know, this is taqdeem al-jar wal-majroor, ala al-fi'l. So for example, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, akul. But it's actually akulu Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. When you move Bismillah in the beginning, like in English, when I say in using this key, I just start the car. When I use the strange order like that, you know what I've done? I'm actually saying this key and only this key. There's no other way I could have done it. And it's as if when we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, it's a taqdeem suggesting we could never have gotten anything done in our faith. Nothing good would have come of it had it not been on us calling on Allah's blessed name. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. What a remarkable acknowledgement from a believer that everything depends on us just calling on His name. The last thing, because I won't dedicate a session to the word ilah, I'll share it with you now. In the phrase, La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. Some of our scholars believed that the word Allah comes from the word ilah. Like they're connected to each other. But there are other scholars that make very good argument that the word ilah is separate and the word Allah is separate. They're two separate things. Meaning the word Allah is the original name of Allah. It's غير مشتق. It doesn't go back to anything. It's the original name of Allah in all of the scriptures from before, regardless of language. That is the original name of Allah. You can't even find a definition or a translation for it. But then what about the word ilah? What about the word ilah? When we say la ilaha illallah, and your English translations say there's no God except Allah, or there's no one worthy of worship except Allah. You've heard these translations before. I just wanted to give you an appreciation of what you and I are saying, not just in Bismillah, but also in La ilaha illallah, very briefly, just on the word ilah. And I'll conclude for the day, inshallah ta'ala. The first thing I want you to know is alaha in Arabic also means to worship. And so ilah actually means there's no possibility of anyone to be worshipped except Allah. That's a good translation. That's a fair translation. But Aliha also in Arabic means faza'a ilayhi or wuli'a bihi. What that means is when someone is desperate and they don't know who to turn to. Like if, for example, you know, if there's a knock on the door or there's somebody trying to break a window and you immediately, who do you call first? Do you call the authorities? Do you ring the alarm? That first alarm that you do in a time of desperation, that's actually faza'a ilayhi or aliha ilayhi. In other words, when we are at our most desperate moments, when we think that we are completely alone and nobody can help us, there is no one to turn to except Allah. There's no possibility of anyone that we can ever turn to except Allah. And that's captured inside the words, La ilaha illallah. He says, Wuli'a bihi, to be obsessed with someone, to be in need of someone, to feel like you cannot do without them. They call this in psychology a dependency. I can't, you know, if someone feels I can't be alone, I need to have someone with me. That's actually Allah. When someone has Allah with them, they're never alone. كَلَّا إِنَّ مَعِيَ رَبِّي سَيَهْدِينِي Musa says, alayhi salam. My Rabb is with me, He'll guide me. A person who feels that the loneliness can be the scariest, loneliness can be the most painful experience, and Allah takes that away from us, loneliness away from us, because He says, doesn't matter if the people leave you, doesn't matter if your family leaves you, doesn't matter if your friends leave you, doesn't matter if society abandons you, but when you have La ilaha illallah, you'll never be alone. You have Allah to turn to. And so finally, I share with you something so beautiful about the word ilah. It was in Texas many years ago that a missionary I was speaking to, I happened to meet him on a flight. He came to me and told me, our God is love, but your God, He's not love. Because you know, Jesus is love. And I said, where did you learn that our God is not love? You have Allah. And you have ilah, but you don't have love, you know? And I said, okay, well, I could show him, you know, وَهُوَ الْغَفُورُ الْوَدُودُ Quran says Allah is extremely loving. He says that. But even in the word ilah, what people don't know, the Arabs are really a remarkable people. The ancient Arabs used to have 14 different words for love. How many did I say? 14 different words for love. Like it's like 14 different kinds of virus. Which one is he infected with? You know, and so for each one of them, they had a description. So they would have al-hawa, al-subuwa, al-shaghaf, al-wajd, al-kilf, al-ishq, al-najwa, al-shawq, al-wasab, al-istikana, al-wud, al-ishra. And then towards the end, they have two more, al-walah and al-hiyam. The last one, number 14, is when love kills you. Number 14 is the kind of love that you just I'm just dead. Okay? The love that kills. And you don't wish that on anyone. But the one before that is actually called al-wala. And al-wala is a kind of love. They describe it, يُعَبَّرُ عَنْ غِيَابِ السَّعَادَةِ بِغِيَابِ الْمَحْبُوبِ They say, when the one you love isn't there, you can't be happy. That love, that when they're there, you're happy, and when they're not there, you can't be happy. And the word for that in Arabic is wala. And wala is argued by many grammarians as the origin of the word ilah. From wilah, it actually becomes muqallab, the waw became alif and became ilah. In other words, there is no genuine love and there's no real happiness in life that a human being can find with Allah absent from their heart. Happiness cannot exist. Joy cannot exist. Love cannot exist without Allah in the heart. That's part of the meaning of La ilaha illallah. And that's the Allah we're calling on when we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. How often we think of Allah as the one who punishes and the one who's going to get you. I mean, we teach kids that. It's so scary. We teach our children things like, don't eat that cookie. Allah's going to be very angry. And I can guarantee you, if that child died, Allah will not be angry and not ask him about a cookie. I can guarantee you. Allah, you're angry. Allah isn't angry with a child. Not over any cookies. They're ma'soom. They're not going to be questioned about what they do. But we teach people early on, even Muslims teach Muslims early on, that Allah is angry or Allah will punish or Allah is watching and you better watch out and you better fear Allah. Yes, fearing Allah is part of the equation. But where does Quran begin with? Does Quran begin with scaring us about Allah or making us love the one who gave us this life? Making us fall in love with Him and making us feel like we will always be alone without Him. There are people that are literally afraid to turn to Allah because they're too scared to remember Him. Our fear should be overrun by our love for Him and our desperation for Him. And I pray that this is the month that you and I find that love, that genuine love for Allah Azza wa Jal. That when we call on Allah's name and we say Bismillah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, that we recognize how much Allah is giving us out of His love. How much He's taking care of us. How many of His names are being utilized by us and we don't even know. We don't even know. May Allah Azza wa Jal make us a people who say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim with their tongues and they also say it with their hearts. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.